had a really long day of a lot of technical sessions, so I'm sure you're in a great place right now. And we've kept banking and technology, two of the most boring things in the world for some people, for the last spot. We're not going to talk a lot about this technical stuff. We're going to have fun, okay? So, what was it that each of you thought about when you woke up today morning? Think about it. I'll give you a moment to think about it. Were you thinking of WSO2Con? Well, this is what I was thinking about. WSO2 is going on their company trip next week to the southern beaches. So I've already started dreaming about it. The more responsible ones generally think of things like this, buying their dream home. Some of my friends who run their own businesses wake up to this. They want to grow their business. But most of the time, what we find is that banking gets in the way. If you can read what's happening over there, it says, get Airbnb discounts with the right credit card. How many times have you seen advertisements like that and realized you have the wrong credit card? Sometimes we've spent so much time looking out for that perfect house, and then we finally find it, and we finally want to own it. And then just to find out that we are sunk in all this paperwork. And it's the same for businesses as well. Many of the businesses who want just to get some facilities for working capital or just a loan to expand their business often find themselves just sunk in the paperwork, or the banking system has really not helped them achieve that end goal that they wake up in the morning thinking about. This is a really great idea. This idea was presented by our customer, Wells Fargo, at the US Con that we had, US conference, WSO2 US conference we had 1 month ago. And he explained the journey that banking has taken. This is, you'll make sense of this when I take you through this journey. So think about your families and try to position some of your family members within this journey. Now, these branch banking and phone banking is where I would typically position my grandfather. I don't think he ever had an ATM card, and he belonged in that stage. My dad, 75 years, he's going to be next month. He's also kind of in that stage, but he has a card. He has an ATM card, and he's a little bit better, a little bit more advanced than my granddad. My husband, who is the same age as me, but listens to Gold FM, for the Sri Lankans in the audience, they identify with Gold FM. For those who've traveled from abroad, Gold FM is a Sri Lankan channel that plays 60s, 70s music. So he has kind of progressed towards a little bit towards online banking. Me, I'm very comfortable with online banking and mobile banking. Of course, I have an ATM card. Of course, I have to go to the branch sometimes when I want to do something complex. But I really wish I didn't have to do it. And I'm sure many of you, all of you, in fact, will identify with that. My son is 2 years old, and he's not going to want to do any of those things. He would want to have his own experience. He would want to do the banking through his own experience, not the experience that the bank forces him to use, which is something that we are used to and the banks have taken for granted, but that's changing. And if you look at the banks, let's look at, there's the majority Sri Lankan audience, so let's look at the banks in Sri Lanka. If you look at asset size, leading the pack is Bank of Ceylon, People's Bank, Commercial Bank, HMB, Sampath Bank, Nations Trust, National Development Bank. I'm not sure whether I got the order completely right, but that's generally the order. And that order is there because of asset size. And that asset size is because those banks are really strong banks in terms of asset size. They've grown over the years. And people flock towards those banks because they feel that they are very safe. But now, if you really think about the audiences or the consumers that's coming up, in the next 5 to 10 years, the generation of my son is not going to care how big this bank is or how long they've been around for. They're only going to care about the great experience that they can get to do the things they want to do. And that's what is going to redefine how the banking usage or how these banks rank in the next 5 to 10 years. And that is where open banking via open APIs come in. And that's going to change the landscape of banking. So we've had the branch banking, phone banking, ATMs, online banking, mobile banking, and the next thing is API banking. So what is it really? Let me define it. Let me give you somewhat of a Wikipedia kind of definition for it. It means that banks have to securely expose customer data with the customer's consent, which is the most important thing, to regulated third parties via APIs. In a graphical format, this is how it pans out. This is now where we have individual interactions with banks and merchants. And the world of open banking is where there are third parties who provide great customer experiences and take care of the banking, aggregating, payment initiation by themselves. So what we deal with and what we interact with is the third party, but what we actually use is the banking services. So let me make it a little bit more realistic to you and show you this little demonstration that my team put together. So this is not the greatest user experience. We are not providing this the third-party kind of experiences, so we are not the best to design this. But this is just a view of how things change. So typically, if you were purchasing something online, you'd want to pay for it. And then, instead of you having to type in all your credit card information or whatever, you'll get redirected to your third-party provider who's providing payment initiation on behalf of you. So you can select which bank you want to pay with, because this is the third party who has aggregated all these banks for you. So you select which bank you want to pay with. Now, this bank is getting an instruction from a third party to do a transaction on your behalf. So how does the bank go ahead with this transaction without knowing who's behind this transaction? So customer identification and customer consent to go ahead with that transaction is the most important part of this transaction. So at this point, you will be either redirected to the bank's authentication mechanism, which is what we are showing here, or there are other mechanisms where the third party can embed the authentication of the bank to their software, and basically, end of the day, in whichever way, ensure that you authenticate yourselves and tell the bank, I am the actual person behind this transaction. And most often than not, especially if it is a high-value transaction, it will be a multi-factor authentication, or strong customer authentication, not just user credentials, which can be compromised, but it uses, you know, one of the three things, like knowledge, something you own, something you are, or something you know. So we've used a one-time password. So you've authenticated yourself and I've said, this is Seshika, I want to do this transaction, but the bank wants to also make sure that I understand what I'm doing. So it gets explicit consent from me, gives me all the information about what I'm about to do, allows me to make some choices or tell him which account I want to pay with, and then captures that consent and just lets me go through with the transaction. All right? So that's payment initiation. The other thing that, the other most common use case we see is third parties aggregating financial information among different banks for their consumers. So I'm sure many of you, I'm sure all of you have more than one bank account at different banks. How awesome would it be if we had the financial literacy to understand our funds distributed across all these different banks? Not just our funds, but also our commitments. And if someone can do that analysis for me, aggregate all these different financial institutions who provide financial services for me, that would make my life much easier. So there are these aggregators who basically do this. And in the open banking world, they do it in a much more secure way by accessing this data via APIs. So here's an example of one of those aggregators. You log into your aggregator, you can see all your you know, financial information aggregated here in terms of accounts, transactions. And then let's say I have a new bank account I want to add to this. I go through the same process. I need to first authenticate myself twice over and provide consent and say which accounts I want this third party to see and go ahead and add them. So that got updated. Here we are, Citizen Bank is added. So that's what it is in real life to be able to, as a consumer, to be able to use this open banking. So this picture, I drew this picture about 2 months ago. There was another banking conference in Sri Lanka, and we were speaking at that, and I drew this picture. And within these 2 months, this picture has changed. What has happened, and I'll explain what this picture is, the blue, the countries in blue, they are now regulated. Their banks are regulated. And they're mandated to open up APIs for third-party use. The countries in green are pending regulation. And the countries in orange or yellow, whichever it is that you see, I see it as orange, there can be regulation coming up, but with or without regulation, banks are basically doing open banking, or certain banks are opening up APIs with or without regulation. So it's just Greenland who's just not caught up with this picture. So what I wanted to say is from 2 months ago to now, this picture has changed. That's how soon open banking is getting adopted all over the world. So if you're not thinking about it now, in the next 2 months, it might be too late. So having spoken to these different banks across the world, both in the regulated world and in the unregulated world, Sri Lanka, for example, there is no regulation. But obviously, you will know from the speaker who's coming up next as well that we have already started opening up APIs in Sri Lanka. And we hear a lot of different stories from these different consumers, rather different banks. It's quite amazing how in the regulated world, most of the banks look at this as a regulatory requirement and do this grudgingly. Whereas in the unregulated world, the banks who do it because they see the actual value of it, the actual potential of open banking. In the regulated world, banks think, come on, why do I have to open up APIs? I am losing the relationship I'm going to have with my customer, or the relationship I've built over so many years with my customer, and this third party, this new, young, and sexy third party is going to come in the middle of me and my customer, and I'm not going to have any hold on my customer. They think of this as a loss of identity because, come on, we've been the ones who've been providing financial services over the last so many years, and now these third parties are going to come and take a piece of that pie? And they see this as an increased competition because now, when these third parties aggregate banks and put them in one dashboard and people can evaluate services given by different banks side by side, then it's far more possible for people who are banking with a particular bank to see the value of other banks and move their accounts to the other banks. And because of all of these things, most of these banks look at it as a loss of revenue. However, in the unregulated world, especially the banks who are doing this because they see the value, they see this as an opportunity. They see this as a new ecosystem, and they want to have the first mover advantage. And we'll talk about those benefits. They see it as breaking traditions, especially, as I said before, that age-old ranking system of ranking banks from their asset size or their revenue is going to be irrelevant in the near future, where the newer generation does not care. They only care about how easy it is to achieve their end goal, and that's the bank that they will bank with. And obviously, this new ecosystem, and I'll show you, provides great opportunities for market expansion. So let's see how that works. So as I said before, these third parties are going to come in and aggregate financial information from these banks for the consumer. So what that does, or what that enables for the first time, is a very rich data set of consolidated consumer financial information at the level of the third party. Because now, at the third party level, you're accumulating or aggregating financial data for a customer among many banks, which was not done before. So now, there are lots of interesting financial insights at the level of the third party. So let's put some numbers in there. Let's think of this customer. Let's call him John. Let's say John has $1 million account with Bank B. So Bank B has categorized John as $1 million consumer or customer. But if John has $10 million with Bank A and $5 million at Bank C, now, John is not $1 million customer. He's a multi-million dollar customer. Now, what if Bank B had that information? They would treat John differently, yeah? So, what some of these banks, both in the regulated world and the unregulated world, is doing is they are not stopping at opening up the APIs and telling the third parties, okay, come and take all the data, you know, come and share the pie with us. They're going a step ahead, and they're saying, we want a part of that pie as well. We will open up our APIs, but we'll also act as third parties who will do the aggregation ourselves. And many of the banks are doing this in some way or form. Some banks are doing it by acquiring fintechs and using their expertise to provide the third-party services, and some banks are just creating those third-party applications in-house. And some banks are doing it in collaboration with third parties. So if the bank provides these third-party services, what that enables the bank to do is to see the customer beyond the limits of their own bank. So Bank B then can see that John is a multimillionaire. That enables Bank B to provide customized offers and recommendations to John, basically incentivizing him to bring those funds back to Bank B. So if he has $10 million at Bank A and $5 million at Bank C, maybe Bank B will say, For all deposits over $10 million, we provide you a better interest rate. That's not all. Now, this green or blue box, whatever color you see, which says consolidated customer financial information, that also has some information that's really useful for other industries. If you really think about it, if we are aggregating financial information, that has a lot of information about what people are buying, purchase patterns, what type of holidays are people taking, what type of airlines are they flying on, what type of cars are trending. Yeah? So all of these other industries are really interested in finding out what's trending and what's not. And they would pay to have that insight. So this gives another opportunity to banks who provide these third-party services as well to analyze that data and provide anonymized, aggregated insights to these industries. You can't provide customer-specific information because that would breach data sharing and data protection. But you can anonymize and aggregate information and provide general insights to these other industries. And that is a new business expansion opportunity for banks where you provide new digital services to a completely new consumer base. So there are lots of opportunities. There are lots of opportunities, not just in terms of opening up the APIs, but actually using those APIs by the bank themselves to open up new digital services and products and expand business. So what happens in the end is that right now, we go to the bank in order to achieve our dreams and goals. We go to the bank and we save up for our children or for ourselves, or we ask for a loan to build that house or buy that car or to grow our business. We go to the bank. But in the next 5 to 10 years, if the bank doesn't become a part of customer lifestyles, the bank will die. So if you really think about this, this is not just a technology problem, or this is not just a compliance problem. This is much larger than that. This is changing the entire landscape. So what's happening is that if you don't look at this from a larger perspective, you will just click or check that compliance requirement, but die in the water. So we want to look at this from different angles, from a vision perspective. We need to understand that this is not just a regulation. I know that right now we don't have a regulation in Sri Lanka for this, but it's coming. And on that day that it comes, if banks look at it as a regulation, that it'll remain there. But if banks look at it as a business opportunity, then you change with the times and you are able to expand your business opportunity. When it comes to the people who should be concerned about this, it's not just compliance and IT who needs to worry about this. It's everyone. Business banking, retail banking, treasury, HR, everyone needs to understand what open banking means and change their business processes accordingly, because this is how banking will work in the future. In terms of culture, and this is a mantra that WSO2 goes by, take nothing for granted, keep innovating, because open banking is only the beginning. And open banking right now is regulated in different regions in different ways. And a few years from now, things are going to converge. And that's how it happened in just normal banking regulation as well. It started with different regulations in different parts of the world, but now everything is internationalized and everyone has converged into a single standard. And we will have that in open banking as well. Right now, in Europe and UK, they follow a different format. Australia is going to go next. And even within Europe, there are different standards. But in the future, everyone's going to converge. So if you get an API manager and identity and access management technology to open up APIs and you want to call it a day, think again. You're going to have to keep innovating in order to keep with these times. And from a technology perspective, that's exactly it. There is no solution or there is no single product that's going to get you open banking compliant. You need a platform that can take you through this journey where you start with opening up APIs, but you use that platform that can do API management, identity and access management, analytics, integration, to cater to the evolving regulatory and business requirements. So if you think about WSO2 Open Banking, we've thought of that entire journey. So open APIs is only the beginning. And as you saw in that demonstration that I did, it's not just about opening up APIs. The most important thing, in my opinion, in open banking is the security or the identity and access management. Because without consent from the consumer, you're going to be in a lot of trouble if you open up consumer APIs, consumer data via APIs to third parties. So this is more an identity and access management requirement as it is an API requirement. And then once you've done the open APIs, you've opened up APIs, what changes or what differentiates the leaders from the rest of the pack is what you do beyond that. And the WSO2 technology stack can be used for that entire journey. If you want to do third-party services, then we provide the technology you need to do API integration, to do identity federation, to do the complex analytics in order for you to enable in other industries to consume your data via insights. So we provide the full technology platform to not just get you open banking compliant, but also to accompany you on that journey towards digital transformation. Thank you.